All right, we're going to get started here with the latest SunMag Solar webinar. I'm John Malawacki. I'm SunMag Solar's educator. And today's topic is internal debate, flat plates versus evacuated tubes. And as always, this presentation is copyrighted by U.S. copyright laws. If you want to use anything in it, please talk to me. All right. Now, I've seen a lot of debate going on, and if you visit the websites around the different companies, you'll see a lot of different things. If a company sells flat plates, amazingly, the debate seems to land on the side of flat plates. If the company sells tubes, then it seems to end up on the side of tubes. Well, SunMag Solar is neutral ground. We sell both types, and I'm a relative newcomer to this industry. I haven't been had 10 years of ingrained things put into my head, so I'm a pretty neutral person too. So we'll try to keep the debate on a neutral basis today. And in order to compare the two different types, I guess we got to talk about how each one works. And most of you may be familiar with what's going on as far as how each one works, but you may not. So let's go over them. Glazed flat plates. Okay, glazed flat plates basically have a frame, some sort of metal frame. Ours are made of either aluminum or stainless steel. This is a picture of our SU2, which is a stainless steel frame. And it's insulated heavily on the back and a little bit less heavily on the sides. Okay, the insulation in our SU2s that you see exposed there is mineral wool. And the front has a glazing, which in the great majority of all cases is glass, okay, usually tempered glass. Thick sheet of tempered glass. And this allows ultraviolet radiation and near ultraviolet and shortwave visible light to come through. And once that gets turned to heat and tries to get back out as long wave radiation, it can't get back through the glass. So that's the idea of the glazing. Allows radiation in shortwave and does not allow long wave out. Behind the glass is the absorber, okay, which is coated onto an absorber plate made of metal, either copper or aluminum. In the case of our SU2 that you see pictured here, it's a copper absorber plate. And the absorber is the very dark blue, almost black, that you see at the bottom of the picture there. And the idea of the absorber is to take in as much of the radiation that hits it and not emit very much at all. Okay, the absorber we use in our SU2s is Pinox, and Pinox is the latest and greatest absorber. It absorbs 95% of the incoming solar radiation and only emits or reflects 4%. The tubes, the copper tubes that you see, are the eventual destination of that heat, and the heat travels by conduction through the absorber plates, the tubes, and then by conduction to the heat transfer fluid flowing through them. The tubes themselves in this particular absorber are header riser or ARP style parallel piping, but we also sell an AL tube, which is serpentine. Okay, there are different ideas behind the tube, but that's where the heat is getting put into those tubes, getting transferred to the heat transfer fluid, and that's how glazed flat plates work. I'm going to concentrate on vacuum heat pipe evacuated tubes, although there are various types, including new pipes, which we carry. Vacuum heat pipes are actually independently plumbed. They aren't connected to the actual plumbing of the system. Each little tube is a little plumbing system in itself. And you can see the each of the tubes, in the picture there, you see it split up. There's the glass tube itself, which is actually a double-walled glass tube. There are single-walled vacuum heat pipes. We don't have one of those, so I'll show you this one. This is double-walled. It's just like your thermos that you have at home, and it uses a vacuum in that space between the walls of glass and insulation. And that little about quarter inch of nothingness is equal to R16 insulation. That's about 5 inches, a little bit more than 5 inches of the pink stuff. So very, very good insulation there. And that next thing that you see made out of aluminum there is the conductor, which can conduct the heat being absorbed by the absorber to the heat pipe in the center. And that little white thing you see there is the insulation that goes on top. The top section of the collector is called the manifold, and there's a pipe going through there, which there is a slot for each of the heat pipes to fit into. And the heat transfer fluid flows through that pipe in the top, and it never enters the tubes at all. Okay, the tubes themselves are little plumbing, isolated little plumbing centers of themselves. This is how a heat pipe works right here. There is a non-toxic fluid inside, okay, mostly distilled water. The radiation, shortwave radiation, comes through. The glass ends up on the absorber, which is sprayed onto the outside part of the inside glass. Okay, that gets transferred to the aluminum conductor, which transfers it to the heat pipe itself, which is made out of copper. The copper transfers it to the fluid in here and actually boils it. There's a partial vacuum in here. All right, that hot fluid travels up along the top surface of the heat pipe and the condensing tube. And there it transfers its heat to the copper in the manifold. And then the manifold transfers it to the heat transfer fluid, which carries it away. The fluid that has its heat taken away from it condenses in the condensing tube back to a liquid and flows back here down into the heat pipe to continue the process. So this whole process works by a convection current right there. And here you see the inside of the manifold, and there's where the heat transfer fluid flows by the heat pipes themselves in contact with the copper of the manifold. All right, in my comparison, I'm just going to use our Titan Power SU2s versus our Thermal Power BHP20s. They are both about 20 square feet in aperture, and it's a fairly good comparison if we're going to crunch numbers. And they are the two that I am most familiar with, so that helps. Just want to say that SunMax collector are certified, SRCC certified. You probably, no matter what collector you pick, you don't want to pick one that's not SRCC certified. It's been tested. There's numbers available for comparison on their site, so you know the output of the collectors, and it's also been tested for stagnation, so it doesn't break down over time. Our collectors are also Canadian Standards Association certified and Solar Keymark certified in Europe. Okay, let's start with our comparison right here, maturity of the technology. Now, when I'm searching for history of solar thermal stuff, there's not a lot of information that I can find, not in books, not on the web. I think the flat plates have been around for about 100 years in some form or another, but according to Wikipedia, a couple of professors at MIT developed a model for glazed flat plates as we know them in the 50s, so let's say modern flat plates go back to the 50s. Evacuated tubes developed in China and Beijing in the early 80s. So obviously the flat plates have the advantage as far as the maturity of the technology. So we have to give that battle to flat plates, although my predecessor used to say the horse and buggy had an advantage over the car too at one time. So that's a little bit debatable. Now, one of the obvious things that is important is roof area that the collector is going to take up. Flat plates, at least our SU2s, the aperture, in case anybody doesn't know what aperture is versus gross area, aperture is the part of the collector that is actually absorbing energy from the sun. Okay, and in flat plates, the aperture area is pretty close to the gross area that the collector would take up on the roof, as you can see. For our SU2s, 94% of the gross area is aperture. Evacuated tubes take a lot more space per aperture. You can see that the net aperture area of our tubes in this situation is only 57%. So this may decide your issue right off the bat if you have limited roof space, okay? Limited roof area, okay? Flat plates definitely have the advantage here. And I know that my predecessor was a big tube guy, but when he built his house, he had limited roof space, and he actually ended up going with flat plates because of that one deciding factor. All right, angle of insulation, flat plates versus evacuated tubes. Flat plates have a flat surface. That's why they're called flat plates, all right? And they have an optimal angle facing one direction only. Now, unless you're between Tropic Cancer and Tropic Capricorn, that's not going to be 90 degrees, except on, you know, a couple days of the year. During the rest of the day, the angle decreases, and I have a diagram that's going to help us out with that. Evacuated tubes have a curved surface, so they can provide a good angle of insulation, the aperture, throughout the day. And they can actually extend the solar day a little because of that curvature. Although there is one caveat here, double glazing. They also reflect more, okay, in some tubes. Now, here's a good diagram to show that if you have the sun overhead at midday, right, and you have your collectors typically south, okay, you're going to have your optimal angle at noon, which would be 90 degrees 2 days of the year. But as the sun rises towards noon and sets away from noon, okay, that angle is going to be less. And the more or the smaller that angle is, the more light will be reflected off of the flat plates and less absorbed. Whereas the tubes always have aperture facing in the best angle. All right, so that's one of the advantages of the tubes. And here's probably an important fact that we should draw in here. Radiation that's sort of lost between the tubes isn't always lost because the tubes are 360 degree absorbers, and so it can bounce back off the roof onto the backs of the tubes. And I don't think the SRCC testing takes this into account because they, I think, lock the back when they test. But if you actually have a reflective roof, okay, and you can buy a reflective paint that you can paint right over the shingles, or if you put your collectors on a metal, shiny metal roof, you are going to improve the performance of your tubes quite a bit. you will actually be collecting energy that's going into the in the gaps between the tubes, and so some of that gross area that's theoretically not being used might actually be being used by the radiation reflected off of the roof. So as far as angle of insulation, I'm going to give the nod to tubes. All right, snow. All right, flat plates, unlike the tubes, are not insulated on the front side. So if you get a coating of snow, all right, it will partially melt and then slide off the flat plate. All right, and you can actually, if you have a heavy coating of snow, you can actually use your system, use heat from your tank to purposely melt the snow off the collectors. All right, and in the summer, that same system, same idea can be used to dump heat. If you go on vacation, you can set it, our controllers have a vacation or holiday setting, you can set it on to dump heat in the summer. So snow usually won't stay on the flat plates because the front side is not insulated. So the thing that gives them a disadvantage in the winter as far as their efficiency actually helps to clear the snow off. Evacuated tubes, on the other hand, have that 360-degree vacuum insulation, and they do not give up heat very easily at all. And so closely, flush-mounted tubes may get a snow layer on them, which is not very easy to shed. This problem can be alleviated by raising them up off the roof or tilt-mounting them. That helps, and a lot of times the snow will fall right through gaps. But that isn't always the case. I noticed that the picture that I have here of the collectors with the snow covering, if you compare that to the picture I have of our thermal power BHP in the top, the gaps are bigger between our tubes than the tubes with the snow covering in the picture. So that would allow the snow to get through those gaps more easily. Right. Now, let's talk about frost, because that's also related, and the tubes will get a coating of frost on them that will not melt off easily if the weather conditions are right. But here is a little experiment done by Todd Paternoster that actually tested these tubes that you see in the photograph on the right, which are frost-covered. Tested them in the morning. He took a thermometer and stuck it in the manifold right in the morning. The blue line on the bottom is the ambient or outdoor temperature, and the red line is the temperature of the collectors, the manifold temperature. And you would be hard-pressed to pinpoint a spot in this graph as where the frost melted off, which it did eventually later on in that morning. And so those tubes were actually producing a lot of heat, even with the frost on them. And even though I'm sure that the performance, the efficiency was less with the frost on them, they were still doing a pretty good job. Still, I'll have to give, as far as snow and frost is concerned, I'll have to give the flat plates their advantage where it's due. Efficiency. All right, let's talk about overall efficiency here. Now, if you look at the SRCC efficiency, I usually use the y-intercept, which I'm going to talk about in the next slide. The ratings really can't be used to compare flat plates and tubes because they're based on gross area. We already know that tubes have lost the battle as far as gross area is concerned. And even if you mathematically compensate for aperture, the comparison still doesn't seem to be very valid. So what you can use is the energy output figures from the SRC, which I will use. They seem to be much more useful. All right. But you can use the y-intercept ratings to compare flat plates to flat plates or tubes to tubes. So if you want to compare one flat plate to another flat plate, one manufacturer to another manufacturer, using those, but just stay with flat plates to flat plates or tubes to tubes as far as the y-intercept is concerned. Alright, before I talk about the actual values from the SRCC, let's talk about this graph, which is a better way to compare efficiency, I think, between tubes. And this graph is found in all textbooks and all articles that compare different types of collectors. And basically, what it's showing is the efficiency, which is easy enough on the left. And then it's got something Ti minus Ta. Now what the heck is that? Well, that is temperature of the inlet. In other words, the temperature of the heat transfer fluid coming into collectors, and temperature ambient, okay, which is the outdoor temperature. One thing that none of these graphs show is negative numbers, and you can get negative numbers. Let's say the temperature incoming the collectors is 60 degrees and the temperature outside is 80 degrees, that's negative 20, which is to the left of the y-intercept. So you can actually get negative numbers, but none of these graphs show those negative numbers. And if we look at the graph, the black lines on the graph, the one that is the steepest is pool collectors, okay? Just unglazed flat plate collectors, very good at picking up heat when the temperature outside is warm, okay, and the incoming collector is cool, our inlet temperature is cool. And you'll notice that their efficiency trails out very, very quickly, and we're really not talking about those today. Now, if you look at the other two lines, they have flat plates and evacuated tubes. The flat plates start off where we, this is often called delta T, the difference between incoming, the inlet temperature and the ambient temperature, and delta T is near zero. Flat plates definitely have an advantage over tubes. So in warm climates, they would definitely have an advantage in warm temperatures. And then they have a not as steep a line as the unglazed flat plates, but a steeper line than the tubes. As you get more and more to the right in the graph, the higher the delta T. In other words, if the inlet temperature goes up, the temperature in your tank goes up, so the water going up to the collectors gets warmer, or the outside temperature gets colder, evacuated tubes start to have an advantage as far as the efficiency. Now, one note, this particular graph shows the crossover point, okay, the point at which evacuated tubes become more efficient at about 15 degrees. Every single one of these graphs that I have looked at has that crossover point in a different spot. A couple of them that I was looking at the other day had it at about 40 degrees Fahrenheit. There was one in the textbook that had it over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so just exactly where that crossover point is, where tubes become more efficient than flat plates, is kind of debatable. It probably depends on the collectors you're testing, all right? But you can't always take what you see in a book or on the web as gospel. I'm not sure exactly what the average place for that crossover point would be. Let's say, as a wild guess, let's say it's around 40 degrees, a little bit more than this, but it also depends on the collectors, as you're going to see. Here's our actual data from the SRCC for our thermal power VHP evacuated tubes and our Titan Power SU2 flat plates. And you'll notice with our tubes, if you compare the A values, all right, they start off pretty much out of par with our flat plate, which I'm not sure how typical that is. According to the graph, it's not typical. But let me explain this chart a little bit in case you're not familiar with the SRCC ratings page. If you start off with the A category, that's to the left of the graph, that I just had up there. Look back at this graph, that's to the left, okay? And that would be, you know, swimming pool heating. It's basically when the inlet temperature is cool and the outside temperature is warm. And then as you go down, A, B, C, D, E, okay, you're getting cooler and cooler temperatures and warmer inlet temperatures. And C might be good conditions for domestic hot water, and D into heating your home, and E into process heating or air conditioning. And you'll notice that as you go down the chart, the evacuated tubes definitely have an advantage. Okay, the cooler the temperature gets, the bigger that gap between the inlet temperature and the outside temperature, evacuated tubes definitely have an advantage. The top category there is amount of BTUs per square foot per day. All right, and the first category is like a sunny day. The middle category is supposed to be like a partly cloudy day. And the last category is a cloudy day. And you'll notice that the evacuated tubes also have an advantage there. Now, we do have to talk about on a daily basis, this is a matter of sense. Okay, it's only in the long term that you will actually see some serious savings based on this. All right, so let's do a little summary of that chart here. Performance, warm temperatures. Okay, flat plates, get the nod. They have a higher efficiency than tubes do. So if you're in a constantly warm climate, okay, flat plates, get the nod. Cold temperatures. Okay, evacuated tubes have to get the nod here. They have a higher efficiency of cold temperatures. Although, snow may negate some of this advantage. Cloudy conditions. Okay, evacuated tubes have higher efficiency in cloudy conditions. So if you're in a constantly cloudy climate, okay, evacuated tubes may be your choice. Now this has nothing to do with the SRCC chart, but we are talking about performance here. So let's talk about wind. All right, maybe you're in a place that's windy all the time. Flat plates will definitely have a lower efficiency in the wind because they are not insulated on the front. And that means that by conduction, they will be losing heat to continually cool air that's not stagnating on the surface of the flat plate. Evacuated tubes have a much higher efficiency in windy conditions because they are insulated all the way around. So in windy conditions, tubes get the nod. All right, and here is a lot of people say, well, cost comparison, it's flat plates hands down. Well, sort of. I looked at the comparison between our flat plates and our tubes. Okay, as far as our SU tube versus our VHP, and I looked at the flat plates with the mounting hardware. Okay, I thought that because the tubes do come with the mounting hardware, so I wanted to do a fair comparison here. And I looked at C conditions, and if you look at clear C, alright, they are about 10% less costly. If you look at mildly cloudy conditions, okay, the comparison comes out to about 5% less. And if you look at cloudy conditions, the evacuated tubes actually come out to be 7% less costly. So the cost comparison may depend on your climate. For most people, the flat plates are going to be a little bit cheaper. All right, but remember, the actual cost of the collectors may be a small part of the actual installation of the system, so I'm not sure how much of an impact this is going to make on your decision. Okay, durability. Flat plates have a metal frame with a thick cover of tempered glass. Evacuated tubes have a much thinner borosilicate glass, and it can be broken. Now, our tubes are rated for half-inch hail, so they're still pretty tough, but they're not going to match up with the thickness of that glass on a flat plate. All right, and tubes also rely on a vacuum, and some tubes can lose their vacuum over time. All right, so flat plates are definitely a little bit tougher here. And the glass and flat, this is just a side note, do break in chunks like the side windows and rear windows of your car, whereas the evacuated tube do break in shards. Now, some people would argue against the durability of flat plates because they've seen poor quality flat plates, and these have built up a glazing on the inside over time. That glazing or that buildup, that film, is usually due to either the flat plates themselves not being waterproof, but mostly because the internal components of the flat plates are made up from materials that probably weren't meant to be subjected to the high temperatures inside flat plates, and so they break down, and it's called outgassing. They give off these materials into the inside of the collector, and then when condensation happens, it collects on the glass and it gets deposited right there on the inside of glass, decreasing the efficiency of the collector. Well, that's really only the case with poor quality collectors. There have been many improvements in the technology. If we look at our SU2s, they are waterproof. They are made out of high quality materials, which have been designed from the get-go to be used in solar thermal panels, so the amount of outgassing should be minimal. And to take care of any outgassing whatsoever and any condensation too, the SU2s are equipped with air vents on the bottom and two on the top at the sides that work by convection to clear anything right out of the SU2. So there shouldn't be any condensation going on in your SU2. There shouldn't be any film developing on the glazing. All right, they are a high quality collector, and that should be a thing of the past as far as high quality flat plates. So as far as durability is concerned, I have to give the nod to flat plates. All right, repairs. Let's say your flat plate does break, a tree falls on it or something, or it does go bad. You got a leak in the plumbing. The system will need to be shut down and the entire collector will need to be replaced. That will be expensive. Labor and equipment costs, that's not going to be cheap. Evacuated tubes, flat plates rarely go bad. Evacuated tubes sometimes do go bad. But if the tube does break or goes bad, individual tubes can be replaced really easily and cheaply without shutting the system down. And the system will continue working just fine, just a little bit less efficient with that bad tube. So you don't have to replace the entire collector. So as far as repairs are concerned, I have to give the nod to tubes. All right, use in drain back. Now the only reason I put this in here, because there's some people telling me, well, you can't use tubes in drain back. Well, yes you can. You can use flat plates in drain backs, and you can use evacuated tubes in drain backs. Obviously, you got to be careful of on the internal piping of your flat plates. You're not going to use serpentines in certain orientations, but generally flat plates can be used very easily in drain back, and so can our VHPs used. The word from the field is our VHPs work just fine, and there's a setup right there, a drain back setup with our VHPs. You can see they're tilted on the bottom, and the only place where the heat transfer fluid goes through is on the top, and so it goes through just fine. And the drain hole, and I don't know how true this is, that some manufacturers have a little bit too much turbulence in their manifold, but I don't know how true that is. you'd have to speak to people who have actually tried this out in the field. Okay, I'm not going to speak about other manufacturers' products, but we have been told that our thermal powers work just fine with drain back. So this, in my opinion, is really a non-issue. All right, installation. Man hours, flat plates, no assembly required. You still have to install the mounting hardware on the roof, but after that it just drops into place. Evacuated tubes, you gotta install the mounting hardware too, and you do have to put every single tube in individually. So that may involve more man hours. So as far as the man hours are concerned, I have to give the nod to flat plates. All right, but how about man and machine power? Flat plates, at least our SU2s, weigh 75 pounds. So they're bulky, they're heavy, and getting them up on the roof will require a multi-man crew and or a mechanical lift. And you don't, if your company doesn't happen to own one of those, that means you're going to have to rent one. All right, and that can get expensive. Evacuated tubes can be a one-man job. So as far as man and machine power, I have to give the nod to evacuated tubes. Aesthetics. All right. Collector appearance. I'm not even taking this one on. There's some people who like tubes. There's some people who like flat plates. Your entire job may be decided before you even have a debate by the preference, okay, the aesthetic preference of your client. Well, I think the flat plates look cool. I think the tubes look cool. So that one is sort of out of your ballpark right there. There may be no scientific debate whatsoever if your clients have a preference in that area. But as long as we're talking about aesthetics, let's talk about mounting options, because how these things that you can mount can make a big difference in the aesthetics of how they fit on the house. Now, our flat plates, they are SU2s, can mount anywhere between 35 to 90 degrees. They have to be upright a little bit because of the chimney air vents. Okay, so, but they can mount vertically. Tubes, because of the way heat pipes work with the convection current, have to be mounted between 15 and 75 degrees. They cannot be mounted completely upright. But just to bring in our U-pipes for a second here, I haven't talked much about them. Our U-pipes can be mounted vertically, all right? Either sideways or upright, doesn't really matter, okay? But if you want to, then you want to mount them vertically. You can do that with U-pipes. Now, one thing that you can't do with tubes is integrate them into the roof, and here you see a very attractive integration into a tile roof with our flat plates. Okay, and another thing you can also do, this is an installation in Austria, you can integrate them right into the facade of the building. So as far as mounting options are concerned, I'm going to have to give the nod to flat plates. Engineering. All right. Now, tubes have a much lower wind resistance when tilt mounted, much, much lower than flat plates. Now, if you are literally attaching them, screwing them right into the rafters, okay, both our flat plates and our evacuated tubes have been wind tested to 130 miles per hour, okay, in their major configuration. So it shouldn't be an issue if you're mounting them directly into the rafters in the roof. Where this may come into play is on a commercial flat surface roof where you do not want to make roof penetrations, okay, and you just want to mount them on cement blocks, okay, without any roof penetrations, and you can do this very, very easily. Now, we've done it with both our tubes and our flat plates, but I want you to notice the difference in the amount of weight necessary to hold down the flat plate. Okay, it takes a lot more engineering, okay, to do this with the flat plate. So as far as engineering concerns, I will have to give the tubes in that right there. Now I saved this one for last, temperature requirement. This is the one thing that may eliminate flat plates as an option, okay? Flat plates, at least your common garden variety flat plate that we're talking about here, can go up to about 140 degrees Fahrenheit, all right? Which is fine for just about every domestic hot water need, all right? And maybe even some radiant heating, all right? Evacuated tubes, on the other hand, can raise the temperature much higher, which would be good for home heating, solar cooling, commercial heating of large quantities of water. Evacuated tubes definitely can raise the temperature higher than flat plates and definitely have the advantage here. Okay, so if you need temperatures higher than 140 degrees, okay, then your option is probably going to be tubes. All right, conclusions. All right. Question may be already decided by the client's aesthetic preference before you even present the options. So if that's not the case, there's obvious situations. If you're heating domestic hot water in Arizona, use flat plates. Baseboard heating in North Dakota, use tubes. Most situations, though, will require a little bit more thinking than that. We can go around the world in China, where they invented tubes. Most installations are tubes. Here's the commercial installation with 24,000 tubes. But if we go to Germany and Austria, where they have probably the best flat plate technology in the world, most of the installations are flat plates. So the issue really hasn't been decided. And that's why you're going to have to put a little bit of thinking into it before you make up your mind. All right. I don't know if I've made your decision easier or harder, but thank you for listening. You can continue this debate among yourselves. Evacuated tubes versus flat plates. I'm John Malawacki, educator for Sunmite Solar, and good day. Trying to keep me honest, Mike.